Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, your mentor Neha Gupta, I welcome you all in this series. You would know that the questions that I discuss are helpful for your RBI SEBI NABARD as well as banking PO examinations. So on that note, let's begin this video. But before that, if you have not subscribed to this channel till now, then do not forget to subscribe. And also you can hit the bell notification so that you get instant updates about the new uploads. This is the Telegram group, guys, where you can enjoy the free quizzes that we provide on this channel. So the link of this Telegram group is in this description below. You can click on that link and join this Telegram group. This is the new course for 2022 RBI Grade B, where we provide you with PDFs, videos and mock tests. Apart from this, you will also get interview preparation through mock interviews. And this is the book kit that you will get if you enroll in this new course. And this book kit contains all the books mentioned here. Right now, we are running a 30% discount on this course. So if you want to get yourself enrolled in this course, then you can use this discount by using the RBI 30 coupon code. And this is the number which you can use to call us if you have any query related to the course, eligibility, examination, anything. So here is our first question. Which company has created the DNA matching software in Interpol's iFamilia global database? We have Mellanox, Aladdin Knowledge Systems, Nice Systems, Smart Research, Tadrin Telecom. These are the five companies. Out of these five companies, the right answer is option D, Smart Research. Now, this is a Dutch company. This company has developed this DNA matching software for iFamilia global database. Now, this global database is basically the first of its kind global database that has been developed by Interpol so that the missing people can be identified. And how is this database going to identify the missing people? Basically, it is going to identify the missing people by matching the human remains of the body or the missing people's DNA with the DNA of the relatives. So that is why it is the first of its kind database that has been created by Interpol. Now let us discuss this database in detail. So the first fact here is that it is going to identify the human remains or the missing people through DNAs of their relatives. Now, the next point of importance here is that this iFamilia has three components. First component is a dedicated global database to host the DNA profiles provided by relatives held separately from the criminal data. So this is very obvious and important to keep the data of relatives different from the criminal data. So therefore, there is going to be a global database that is going to keep the DNA profiles. The second component would be the DNA matching software, which is named as Bonaparte. Okay, so this is again an important fact that you should remember. Bonaparte is the name of the DNA matching software that has been developed by Smart Research, Dutch company. Okay, the third here is interpretation guidelines provided by Interpol. So these are the three components of this iFamilia database. And this is the additional information about Interpol that you should remember. For example, the headquarters members and secretary general of Interpol. So this is, guys, the exact mechanism of iFamilia. So here you can see the DNA of unidentified body or human remains and the DNA of biological relatives of missing people will be centralized, will be kept at this database. Then this database will be analyzed by this DNA matching software named Bonaparte. And then the interpretation will be given by the members of Interpol. So this is how the iFamilia is going to work. So I hope that this much is clear to you. Now we are moving on to the next question. Which of the following countries has been selected to the UN Economic and Social Council for 2022 to 2024 term in the Asia Pacific category along with India? So Afghanistan, Oman, Kazakhstan, only A and B and all of the above are in the options, out of which the right answer is option E. All of the above. Afghanistan, Oman and Kazakhstan along with India. So these four countries have been elected to represent the Asia Pacific region in the UN Economic and Social Council. Now remember, this Economic and Social Council is one of the six organs of United Nations. So this is why it is important. And it has a total number of 54 members. Now 54 is the total number of members, but remember that this time a total number of 18 countries including India have been elected to become the members of this UN Economic and Social Council for this term 2022 to 2024, and out of those 18 countries, India, Afghanistan, Oman and Kazakhstan are elected from the Asia Pacific category. So that was all about this news. But you should also remember that this UN Economic and Social Council was established in the year 1945. So this is the another background fact related to this council. Your task is to tell me the current president of this council in the comment section below, because that is equivalently important for you to know for your upcoming examinations. Okay, on that note, I'm moving on to the third question of the day. Guys, this is a very important question, so do listen to me very carefully. As per the new tax pact agreed by G7 for taxing multinational companies, the minimum corporate tax threshold should be at least -%. So we have 15, 20, 25, 10, 12. Out of these 5 options, the right percentage is 15. So now what is this news all about? Basically, therefore, a meeting of G7 finance ministers and central bank governors, where all the members of the G7 have agreed to levy a tax on the multinational companies, and that tax threshold should be 15%. Now, what is the reason behind levying this tax? Guys, you would have also heard about JAFA tax. JAFA stands for Google, Apple, Facebook and Amazon. So these are the 4 tech giant companies based in US, but they were reaping a lot of profits in European countries. Therefore, there was a high demand from the European countries to levy tax on those countries because they were selling their services in those countries but paying the taxes back at their home country. Therefore, the countries that were the marketplace for these companies were getting nothing in return to the sales that the companies were making. Therefore, they have demanded that there should be a tax that should compensate them enough so that they can let those companies use their marketplace. Okay, so this you can say is an evolved version of that debate only in order to levy tax on those multinational companies which are reaping profit in other countries, irrespective of their headquarters or their physical presence in the marketplace countries. Therefore, all these G7 countries have agreed to levy at least 15% of the corporate tax on these companies. Now let us understand this news in a bit detailed manner. Okay, so this is the first fact that you should remember, that the G7 finance ministers and central bank governors meeting was chaired by the UK Chancellor Rishi Sunak. The next point here that you should remember is the number of members and the name of the members of G7. The third point here is very important for our understanding of this news. So basically, this point is saying that under the new agreement, countries where the big firms are operating would get the right to tax at least 20% of profits from the big multinational enterprises. Okay, and what would be its impact on India? For India, it is going to be a win-win situation. Why? Because the current tax regime of India has higher tax rates. And if this 15% tax rate is implemented, then this means that the investment would become cheaper in India, tax rates would decrease in India, and therefore it is going to help India to attract more investment. So it is going to be helpful for India as well as investors so that they can invest in India at cheaper tax rates. So I hope that this is clear to you. The implementation is going to take some time because this is just the pact agreed by the G7 countries, but it needs to be presented to the G20 country, and the more countries sign this pact, the more rigid it would become. Therefore, it is going to require a lot of time for now for its implementation. So that was all about this news. I hope that you have understood it well. Remember that this 15% is basically the minimum threshold that has been agreed upon by these G7 countries. And this 20% is different from this 15%. This 20% means that the countries are now eligible to charge 20% of the profits of these multinational companies. I hope that you can understand the difference between this 15% and 20%. 15% is the minimum threshold of the corporate tax. Moving on to the next question, which company has announced to develop world's first carbon neutral cement plant? So basically, let me first tell you that this is not going to be a new plant. This is going to be an existing facility that will be upgraded to the world's first carbon neutral cement plant. Now, which company is going to do this? It is going to be done by this Heidelberg Cement. Now this Heidelberg is a place in Germany. So here you can remember that this is a German based company. Now this facility is in Slite. Slite is basically a municipality in Gotland. Gotland is an island of Sweden. So remember that Slite is located in Sweden. Okay, Slite is a place in Sweden. And there this facility is located. Now this facility is going to be upgraded into the world's first carbon neutral cement plant by the year 2030 by this company Heidelberg Cement. I hope that this is clear to you guys. Now on that note, can you tell me the capital of Sweden? So this is your task, find it out and tell me in the comment section below. Next question is, who has been appointed as the CEO of HSBC Bank India? So we have five options: Anand Mohan Bajaj, Hitendra Dave, Sunita Sharma and Srinivasan Baldev Purushoth. Out of these five options, Hitendra Dave is the right answer. Now guys, who is the CEO of HSB Bank Global? The global CEO of HSB Bank, it is Noel Quinn. And the global headquarters of HSBC is located in London. In India, the HSB Bank is headquartered or is located in Mumbai. So remember, the global CEO is Noel Quinn, Indian CEO is Hitendra Dave. The global headquarters is in London, Indian headquarters is Mumbai. The tagline of this bank is "Together we thrive." This is the tagline. So this much is the information related to HSB Bank that you are required to memorize for your phase 1 of RGS heavy NABARD examination. And that's all for today's video. I hope that you have enjoyed the video and learned something. And in case you face any kind of trouble in understanding anything, then feel free to ask me in the comment section below. Thank you so much for watching this video.